There's the 90s RoboCop series? Yeah, there was. Don't be surprised. Most people try to forget about RoboCop after the second film. Didn't help that the remake made things worse. Plus, you had Red Letter Media making fun of Pudface Morgan from this series, which, they're right, the series had dumb ideas, but I will give RoboCop 90s some credit. It tried its best to capture what the original film brought. Of course, it couldn't bring the R-rated gore and action of the first film, and it toned down OCP. They're more idiots versus the evil company out to kill everyone. It also retooled a few things and put in new characters. But it kindly ignored RoboCop 2 and 3, mainly because the pilot used a scrap version of RoboCop 2. Maybe if this was made instead of what we've got, the franchise might have been in a better spot. So it went back to Alex's struggle being human and a robot, not able to face his family. Richard Eden plays the new Murphy, who's 1,000% better than Robert Burke. Burke was miscasted in RoboCop 3. It felt like he was trying to be Rambo or stereotype action dude. Robo is not Stallone. Screw off with that. They did try to get Weller for the series, and you could see it in the writing, but that third film failing screwed that. Eden is more soft and more internalized than Peter Weller. Think Patrick Stewart. You have to get used to him, but I would say by the time you get 4 episodes in, Robo's Robo. You know the violence factor's gone. But how's RoboCop under a TV budget? I will say the Canadian production was faithful to the movies. He has all his gadgets from the films, the data spike, the feet rams, his sidearm, and of course his look, all are retained. No jetpack. The series did cost $1.5 million per episode. They even did some improvements over the makeup when he's in the chair charging. His programming and rules that he follows are kept as is, including him getting screwed by OCP every now and again. Oh, if you remembered all those funny ads in the original film, this series also keeps that. We have Delta City's new casters, and they had a run of animated shorts through most of the series, showcasing a superhero family kind of like the Incredibles, where they try to sell products that are horrible for kids, keeping up with, yeah, the city's still crap. We got one almost every episode, but they started repeating them a little bit before the series finale. Meat and potatoes time. What's different from the films? None of the actors come back from the movies, but they don't just recast them. Besides Alex and his family, everyone is new. Replacing Murphy's partner is Detective Lisa Madigan. She's much like Lewis in the original, not as cold since Lisa's never went through the hell that Robo got in. She became Alex's partner because she saw him as human, didn't care one bit that he was a robot. She's rough in the early episodes. It's a problem for everyone in general, so if you just see the first 3 episodes, it easily turns you off, but stick it out. Things improve as they go along. There's a lot more of the technical side of RoboCop featured, so if you loved when he had his helmet off or when you saw his brain, the series fulfills that really good, including an episode where one of his arms was crushed and was disabled pretty badly. He also has a bigger repair team with a new character, Charlie Lippincott. He's like Gyro Gearloose from DuckTales. Smart, but a goofball, falls for things pretty easily. Replacing Warren Reed is Tigertron himself, Blue Makuma, playing Stanley Parks. Just like Reed, Parks is a hard ass, doesn't take any kind of bull, and protects his precinct from crap OCP throws at them. He doesn't get much to do often, but is used more than Reed was, being active in the field. Sadly, he doesn't get any real focus episode. Since the series went more kid-friendly, they included a young girl named Gadget. She basically was Gadget from Rescue Rangers, an orphan who kept running away from social services because they were a crap company. She always ended up at Parks' precinct, eventually barging into Robo's service room, which triggered some of his memories of his son. She became a focal point that linked characters to the main story in the pilot. After the closure of the foster home, Parks agreed to adopt Gadget, so she becomes a main character who periodically gets used. Gadget's mainly there for Alex's son to be a part of various episodes. Is she annoying? In some episodes, a lot, but she has her place and got some good ones, especially helping Jimmy get fleshed out. Of course, the series would need someone from OCP to be a part of the group, which is where the OCP chairman comes in, the old man being replaced from the original movie. Chairman still doesn't get a name here. This was one of the changes I didn't care for. One of the things OCP did in the films they were a crap company, which they still are, but the chairman comes off as a fool that doesn't know better, which worked in early episodes, like his first focus ones where he sees how garbage everything really is. But after that point, he kept being stupid just to have villains come back or use the company resources as a front. It made him look really bad, almost like he was doing it on purpose. All they had to do is have a rival company be the evil corporation, which they tried in a few episodes, then just magically removed it. The last of the new characters comes Dana Powers, who's the focal point of the pilot. Think Selina Kyle from Batman Returns, where she started off as this ditzy secretary, then got killed becoming Catwoman. Same thing happens. Dana Powers was the secretary of Chip Chaykin, who worked under Dr. Crazy Milardo. Yeah, they went there. OCP had this dream of Delta City being run by Neurobrain, an AI, or they thought was an AI, controlling power, fuel, heating. Yeah, that's a great idea. Have a city run by one central point. That doesn't paint a target on you. Milardo left out one key detail. Neurobrain used an actual human brain. Chaykin would kill homeless people, but that didn't work, so eventually killed Powers, which was the brain that finally survived the transfer. But they didn't know Dana's soul would stay alive. She's basically like Andromeda, has a holographic body but can control the city at will and all kinds of hardware, which also includes RoboCop. Milardo attempted to kill Powers a second time. RoboCop figured out everything and got Milardo and Chaykin in jail. None of the main villains get killed, so they can come back every so often. This is where Pudface Morgan comes from. The writers probably thought the whole mutated burn guy from the first film looked cool, so they wanted someone like that again. He's Robo's foil, Batman's Joker, but nowhere near as good. Oh, he kills and screws up the city any way he can. There's one episode where he fakes being in the OCP chairman. He has the ability to change his face, but he acts really stupid whenever Robo shows up. He just goes crazy and wants him dead, so he gets caught all the time. The series has the run-of-the-mill style episodes. Someone tries to frame RoboCop for a murder, OCP sends out an untested drug that causes a psychotic outburst involving Lisa, RoboCop has to protect the chairman from an assassin. There's a couple episodes that are stupid, one about Pudface Morgan on a reality TV show following him around being a criminal. Like, that makes any sense. Really good one involving Jimmy and Nancy, where Robo finds out that the OCP screwed up people on welfare. They couldn't go back to work while on it, so they got involved in a protest, getting arrested, Robo getting them out, him forced to face his son for a whole episode. He tries to form something with Jimmy. Well, Gadget technically forced him to. It's slowly got better. We also got to meet Robo's parents. His father used to be a cop, his mother a teacher. We also find out what happened to Gadget, why she was orphaned, and her real name, with a big finale episode involving Milardo, Chaykin, and Morgan teaming up to kill the president. It's what you expect from a 90s series. It's fine, it's passable, you get good story beats from everyone, but nothing really evolves the universe. You could see the PG rating restricts what they could do. There was one episode that made RoboCop go after Commander Cash, the animated superhero shorts, some guy dressed up as him. It was so tame, the episode was rated G in some countries. I'm torn with the show. It's a worthy follow-up to RoboCop 1, better than that crap CGI talking head and the cursing kid, but it just didn't go far enough. They shouldn't have cared about kids liking Robo. Push PG-13 as far as you can go, and that's it. The flaw the series had was being stuck on repeat. You'd have Pudface be bad, get caught, over and over again. There was no true growth or stakes, compared to like Batman going after the Riddler or Poison Ivy. The city felt small, they had action moments, but far in between boring ideas. In a perfect world, I would have liked if the cast from the series was in a R-rated movie where they could go all the way with ideas, still retaining the good parts the series gave. It's 50-50 if you like it. If you were forced to watch this or RoboCop 3, watch this. If you really hated RoboCop 2, at least watch the pilot. You'll see what one of the abandoned plots would be like. I prefer this version. The RoboCop franchise really can't be a franchise, even if it's rated R. There's only so many things you can do. It had a really great first film. It should have stayed that way. I'm not saying it's not possible to make something good with it, but after two sequels, this series, those other short films, and the pointless reboot, it's best to just leave it to rest. It doesn't need to turn into the Terminator franchise. Thanks for checking out the video. Subscribe if you want to see more from me, and if you remember a movie or a show that's been long been forgotten, good or bad, leave it as a suggestion below. I'm always on the lookout for obscured stuff.